know, when you have politician, they sometimes their schedule caused them to run a little late. So, but anyway, for those that attended the Nyumburu Culture Center Martin Luther King program yesterday, we want to thank you. And if you didn't, it will be up on Nyumburu website for you to, you still will be able to view it. So at this time, I'm going to turn it over to our president, Mr. Solomon Kamajan.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Appreciate it. And just to reiterate what Ms. Carswell said, Delegate Jazz Lewis, who is the State of Maryland delegate from District 24, he was going to join us just after the 12 o'clock hour. However, he has a bill that he needs to, there was an interview that came up. He has a bill that he's, that he has authored, and he has an interview with a news publication about that bill. And as soon as that's done, he, you know, he told me late last night that he should be on the call around 12:20. And as soon as he gets on, we'll get, you know, we'll get rolling with Jazz. I'll introduce him and let him go in. And then we want to leave ample time for questions, answers, you know, comments and the like. So first and foremost, I want to pay homage and respects and you know, extol the tremendous e-board that I'm surrounded with on a week-to-week basis, you know, for BFSA. And it starts with parliamentarian Ann Reese Carswell, who just opened up, Vice President Brandon Dula, who is on the call. We have Audrey Stewart, who is our non-exempt rep, who does some tremendous work advocating on behalf of non-exempt workers. We have Dr. Ronald Ziegler, who is our senior advisor for BFSA. I don't see her on the call yet, but Ms. Tina Laurick, who is BFSA's treasurer, Dr. Joseph Richardson, who is the faculty advisor for BFSA, and without their due diligence and dedication to this organization, a lot of blood, sweat, and tears goes on behind the scenes. I can tell you that a lot of stuff goes on behind the scenes, and they do a tremendous job. And so, before Jazz gets on, we wanted to open up, and I'm going to turn it over to Vice President Brandon Dula, because we kind of wanted to gauge where you all are at. We have that cliche. Sometimes we always ask people, "How are you doing?" But we want to make sure that we mean it. So we really, you know, we're only as strong as our members are. So we want to just kind of find out how everyone's doing. We're still in the midst of a raging pandemic. It has not slowed down a bit. And I will remind people not to let your guard down just because the vaccine is out there. This is no time to let your guard down. Even Anthony Fauci said that we don't know how well any of the vaccines are going to cover people. So you're still going to have to practice social distancing and you know, until this thing is mitigated in a significant way. So Vice President Dula, I turn it over to you.
Okay. So again, thanks to everybody for joining the call and welcome. And so just trying to gauge how people are feeling, thinking about, as Ms. Criswell said, 2020 going into 2021. And so how are people feeling, I guess, at this point in time in the year? It's a new year, but as she was saying, we have all the same problems. So what are people feeling, thinking about, even thinking about sort of the campus opening up? Again, on February 1st, I guess, what is that, coming up next week or so?
January 25th,
right. So what are people thinking about campus? Just trying to gauge people's thoughts and feelings.
Brandon, this is Fuller, and everybody, hi. You know, obviously being in student affairs, of course, we function jobs and people based on having students on campus, and so it's a mixed feeling for us. You know, we obviously want people to be safe, and we want, you know, we don't want the students, I mean, to get the COVID or to pass it around. And at the same time, we want people to have their jobs, and so it's a tough place to sit in that spot. But you know, that's something that's been, you know, weighs on my mind when I think of the economics of what's going on right now. So
thanks for that. Economics is probably on everybody's mind. Other folks.
This is Dr. Z, Brandon, if I could say something. So I'm gonna maybe take a different approach, I guess. I hear what Fuller's saying. I mean, like in terms of, you know, from that perspective, I wanted to just kind of like open it up or bring up the national landscape, so to speak, you know, in terms of what happened January 6th, because, you know, the more and more I watch all these videos that they have on TV about, you know, what happened, and, it, you know, just the more you see the angrier I get. I'm sure many of you in here just angry and stressed about this whole situation. But anyway, last night I saw, my wife and I were watching it, and I couldn't see for sure, and I had just come in into the room where the TV was, and they were showing like the mob, I guess, right along by the Capitol, one of the side streets there. And I thought it was we were talking about pedestrians. And I thought it was some Black folks. And the mob, you know, they were stamping, they had the Black Lives Matter, the rioters, the protesters, they had the Black Lives Matter banner, and they were burning that. But I thought I saw some violence against some Black folks. So I don't know if anybody saw that, but it seemed like the reason I'm bringing that up is because if this kind of stuff is, you know, happening, like, you know, down in the Capitol, then obviously it can happen anywhere in the country. I mean, I'm not saying that, you know, obviously if you go back to the 20s and 30s with lynchings, but, you know, you see a real resurfacing of that, and that hasn't been reported. So I don't know, that was my first question, I guess. I'm asking, like, in all these news channels that are on, you know, MSNBC, Fox, CNN, you know, and they're showing, you know, like all these different versions of what happened on the 6th. So anyway, that really disturbed me, you know, that's one thing. And the other thing that kind of disturbed me is a little bit, like too little, too late, I guess, is the life sentencing of Sean Urbanski, you know, in terms of the murder of Richard Collins III. You know, it's been almost 3 years, and they, you know, they finally, you know, glad he got life, but still, to me, it's like, you know, too little, too late. So anyway, it's, like I said, 20, as Ms. Caldwell said, 20 is gone and 21 is starting now again, but there's a lot of uncertainties, I guess, and a lot of challenges. And, you know, in my leadership role, I will definitely try to remain positive. You know, I'm basically a positive person, but also at the same time, I'm human like all of us. And, you know, these stories just bother me, you know, they anger me, you know, in terms of, you know, trying to deal with that and trying to process that. And I guess in leadership, you know, you have to try to, you know, be diplomatic, but at the same time, these things really bother me, you know, in terms of, I guess, seeing all this happening and then knowing some of the responses that have happened on this campus when it, you know, came to the killing of Sean Urbanski and the administration. It's not always been like a response that shows quote unquote support. So moving forward, I guess, relating that to BFSA and how we're gonna act as an organization and as a group in terms of trying to involve students, trying to get more Black faculty and staff, or get those numbers to improve. You know, it's really very, very daunting, yes, you know, in terms of the structural and now overt racism that seems to be continuing. Right. So that's pretty much what I wanted to say.
Thanks for that, Dr. Z. Other folks?
Well, this is Audrey Stewart. I'd like to say, I've been following a lot of the political changes on the campus. And as we all know, or I'm not sure if all of you are aware, the provost is leaving the end of the month. We've got a whole new transition of new incoming people that are going to be in these positions. I don't know why they're leaving. The current provost, who is the outgoing provost, was only with the university approximately 12 to 15 years, and she's selling out. I don't know, maybe she doesn't want to. be in Maryland anymore, you know, they say family or whatever, or she does not want to work for a Black president. I don't know what it is or the decisions these people are making, but it is just, I'm just curious about this. And I know with every new administration, sometimes they bring in their own people, but our current president did not bring in his own people. He accepted the people that were already there. And now some of them in these key positions are bailing out, as you noticed. So that puts a question up in the air. The other thing that I'm concerned about is once we do get back to campus, what will be the atmosphere on the campus as far as leadership roles that are leading the campus, if you all are following what I'm saying. Because of the racial bias, because of all of this other stuff that's going on, I'm very interested in, it's going to be a very aggressive, curious type of situation on that campus, on any campus, matter of fact, especially Maryland. Another thing that I wanted to bring up was the inauguration that is tomorrow in DC. That is, it is going now, the vote is now supposed to go to the Senate. Okay, even though we won the Senate, but we only control it by, I think, 2 votes. So there are still a lot of Republicans on the Senate. So in order to impeach Trump, they have to have a majority vote, at least 3/4 of a vote, if it's my understanding of the 25th Amendment. So that's going to play out. Then all of a sudden, now they got all of these guards. DC is really on lockdown. I know I have family in DC. I am total lockdown. It should have been that way before these people even got to the Capitol. That is just totally, ridiculous. The whole world is watching the United States at this time. This is not just about the United States and the internal. This is the whole world, and the partnerships that our current president will have to, align himself with other nations around the world. So we are in for some very, very trying times. It's not going to be no overnight thing whether or not Trump is impeached, then never to be able to hold office again. It's going to be, he's already lit a match to all of these existing people out here that had hatred in their hearts. When I watched the filming on TV, and I was just amazed at how many young Black men and some older men were out there with the Trump people. And I know you guys had to see that. And they were fighting for Trump. Okay, I understand your political things, but my thing is, don't you realize the person next to you think that you're with Black Lives Matter and they could kill you? Why are you stupid enough to even be out there, regardless of your political beliefs or not? You should have stayed your behind home. Seriously, I speak from my heart. I don't hold backwards. I don't cover anything up. You all know me like that. I thought that was just very disrespectful, and I'm like, all of the stuff that we've been through as a race, how in the hell, especially men, could you put yourself out there like that on national television with signs holding up, we are for Trump? I saw several of them breaking into the Capitol too. And I'm like, are you kidding me? A lot of these people are not, they don't understand what they don't understand the how could I put this, when other children or somebody or they, even their own kids, look at this stuff and they see their parents out there for these white racists, are you kidding? What the hell did we fight for all these years and still fighting for since we've been in this country? It just does not make any sense to me. And Trump is actually created this kind of atmosphere around the United States that he's trying to make this into another civil war. And it's based on whites against Blacks, and a lot of it on Trump's side, it has to do with the money. Even all his party members have fallen off from the White House, resigned, whatever. They're on his shit list, excuse my language, but they are. you know, his lawyers. Trump is afraid because now he has to face criminal charges. He's going to face Internal Revenue hell. That's how they got Al Capone. Excuse me. If they couldn't get him in anything else, they got him in income tax evasion. Trump has a lot of stuff that he has to face. I was watching PBS last night in London. London is saying the same thing. They had speakers on there. And matter of fact, they had the former Homeland Security chair that went out that was African-American. And he was doing an interview on the London show, stating all of this stuff and saying that it's going to be years before this country even gets back into, you know, flowing like it should. That's all I'm saying. You know, it's more than just the campus. We got to look at the world around us because it affects all of us.
Thanks again, Audrey.
I would like to respond to a couple of things that Audrey said. I did hear that the provost, she will not be the provost, but she will still be working in some department on campus. Also, as far as the Senate, my home state of Georgia,
yeah,
a tie. So therefore, the vice president, you know, elect Kamala Harris will be the one that
break the tie. Yeah. Right. Exactly. So,
yes. That's it.
Well, that I understood too.
Yeah. You know,
but like I said, this is not over by a long shot. It's just the beginning.
Not over.
It is just the beginning. So all I say is keep your family, your children, your loved ones safe. You know, we can't put everybody in bubbles. We wish we could, but the world doesn't work like that. We have to teach our children even more so, especially the younger ones.
Well, hello. My name is Adoree Johnson. You probably have never seen me.
Hi, Adoree. Welcome.
Thank you. So I'm newly working for University of Maryland through Eusebia Victoria Mott for the Cultural and Linguistic Diversity Emphasis Program. Okay. So I just started working through that. And so they let me know about this. And I just kind of wanted to come in and show my face because I know that you all create a lot of cultural programs that we definitely would benefit from. But with that said, as far as what we're talking about of how it affects us, you know, with everything that's going on, for me, it's really just trying to navigate the two Americas that we've always knew. Yeah. But now it's being out, you know, put out there for everyone to kind of understand what we've been talking about or what our people have been talking about in this country for a very long time. Mm-hmm. And what's also interesting for me is that I think there's a couple things that's also been going on outside of these two Americas is the patriarchy system that doesn't really open spaces for women of color that are very much educated. Mm-hmm. And they kind of keep this mediocrity as far as patriarchy is concerned, just like white supremacy. Mm-hmm. And so now it's navigating all these dynamics that has been kind of interesting for me. I don't really know how to navigate it. I am from Tulsa, Oklahoma, so I know I have it's a very vast history concerning, you know, it's the same thing that happened in Tulsa when they rioted and got rid of, you know, Black Wall Street. So for me, it's kind of weird, you know, learning this history and how living in it, it's like, I never thought that I would be a part of something like this. So I'm really trying to navigate as a young person, how do I navigate these Americas as well as navigate a system that doesn't really open spaces for educated women of color. So that's kind of where I am. I just wanted to kind of say that, yeah.
How do you spell your first name? I'm trying to get your name.
It's A-D-O-R-E-E, it's Adoree.
And you're in what department?
I'm in hearing and speech. So
oh, I'm hearing and speech, okay.
I don't know how to contact you, okay.
Thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
Other people, any other thoughts?
Jazz will be on shortly. I just got a text from him, so he'll be on shortly, just finished up his interview, so.
Okay, great.
Anybody else?
Can I pick on a student, Saba? How are students feeling?
Hey everyone, students are struggling as per usual. And for anyone that doesn't know me, hi everyone, my name is Saba. I'm a co-founder of an anti-racist coalition on campus called Black Terps Matter. I don't wanna say happy about hearing about Marion Rankin resigning, but that's definitely was a subject of conversation for us. Mm-hmm. Because we want to see change. And yeah. So we also noted that as like a important systemic change. So we put a lot of pressure on the administration and President Pines in the last 7 months that he's been president. And, you know, I'm happy to say that one good thing that we were able to get out of that is that we are able to finalize the list of 25 goals/demands that the president and is going to be focusing on throughout the next 10 years, actually. So I can just drop that in here. The link to it is on the president's office website, actually. But that's honestly where we were able to leave it. So, yeah. And thank you all for-
I'm looking to real. I can't hear because I'm listening. I'm on this.
Thank you for that.
If you can mute whoever's, if you're not speaking, if you can mute yourself. I don't know. Somebody know who that is so I can mute with it. All right, and just a reminder, if you're not speaking, if you can mute yourself, Saba, thank you. Thanks for that update. And so we have our guest speaker on, and I just wanted to prompt somebody else. I see Mark Seiden on, who is one of the lead union organizers for campus. And so Mark, I definitely hope you have, feel free to, add your input during the question and answer phase, because I know that our next guest is I know that workers' rights are something that's important to him, and I want to welcome on Jazz Lewis. I have his bio up here, and so I kind of hate I don't want to read this because I know this brother too well. I call him my little brother because he came through the halls of Nyumburu all the while he was on campus. He was during a lot of the struggles when the university, and we know that we still have a lot of battles ahead of us currently on campus, but when the administration was really attacking, making some really vicious attacks on diversity, starting with the dismissal of Dr. Cordo Black and the attacks on Dr. Grant Wisdom, who was a tremendous professor, from Jamaica, and she was being attacked. Jazz Lewis and many other students, came together to organize demonstrations, rallies, but also they organized, groups, and they even formed an organization that was geared towards stopping these regressive trends on campus, and to try to put something in place long after they graduated. And so now, this young brother, my little brother, is a delegate in the state of Maryland, District 24. He's an alumnus of the University of Maryland. He attended high school at Charles H. Flowers High School. He lives in Glendale, Maryland right now. He has a newborn son named Miguel, who is a few months old, and he lives there with his wife, Arun, who is from the Bronx, and she went to grad school at University of Maryland. And so without further ado, Jazz, I know you're on. I want to welcome you on, brother, and the floor is yours. And when you're done, our members would like to ask you some questions or have some comments and to know more about some of these great initiatives you and some of your more progressive colleagues are pushing, for the state of Maryland, Prince George's County, and even campus.
Solo brother, thank you for having me on. This is a treat for me. Solo asked me, I don't know, it was a week ago, 2 weeks ago, to hop on. I was like, I absolutely will. Nyumburu was like my home away from home on campus. I don't know if I shared this with them. It's good to see Ms. Carswell, Dr. Z, Brandon Dula. I see Jane. on here as well, and Professor Grant Wisdom. You know, I never told her this, but you know, she kept me in college. She doesn't even know that. I come from a family where all the women, you know, go to college, graduate, do fantastic things. The brothers, we need a little bit of encouragement. You know, I'm the first male in my family to graduate from college. And when I came to Maryland's campus, before I won, had a class with Dorf Grant Wisdom and the empowering work that she was talking about on, you know, the Caribbean and Latin America and stuff like that, but as well as being introduced to Nyumburu, I didn't feel like I would make it through, to be honest with you. It was just such a culture shock, me coming from Flowers High School, where I was in the majority and very affirmed. And then I came to the University of Maryland, and I, you know, to be frank, and I feel like I can have a family conversation here, I just felt like my professors really didn't give a damn if I, existed or not. And not to say that I wanted special treatment at all, but I'm saying going to office hours and things like that, and looking for help, and folks just feeling like they didn't see you, that you didn't exist to them. So I thank all of you all for that. And I hope that I'm making you guys proud. Like I said, born and raised Prince George's County. I went to Maryland 2 times over. I couldn't get away. I represent the 24th Legislative District. Some of the folks on here are constituents, including Dr. Z, who I see in the community from time to time. There's a number of bills that we're working on this upcoming session. So I'm gonna do like a top line overview, and then I'm just gonna pause to answer any questions you guys might have, either about the university or what's happening in the legislature, because this has been, you know, a 4-year cycle, let alone a year like no other. So I can imagine the things that you all wanna talk about. I have a bill hearing 2 days from now on updating the state's parole and probation system for allowing folks who've been sentenced to life or life without the possibility of parole as a juvenile, giving them a fair process to justice. Right now, the process is such that, one, you can sentence juveniles to life without the possibility of parole. The Supreme Court in 2012 deemed that that was unconstitutional, and 2/3 of the states have, you know, change their laws to either, one, outlaw life without the possibility of parole for kids, and two, give them a process if you served over 20 years of getting out. We're working on that. We have a number of celebrities working with us, including an alum called Torrey Smith, who's a former Ravens player, who's gonna be testifying in support of that bill as well. It doesn't entitle people to getting out, you know, within 20 years, if you've been sentenced longer beyond that. But what it does do is create a process where it's not political. It's not the governor deciding, you know, your family's a political insider, so I'm going to give you parole. But those folks who aren't connected, you're going to serve 40 plus years until you die in prison, regardless of your likelihood to recidivate, which we all have data to anticipate. Okay. I'm also bringing legislation this year so that we can start reviewing all of our bills from a racial equity focus. It would go without, you would assume it would go without saying that we have that, but that's not the way we review bills. We review bills in Annapolis from a fiscal standpoint, how it will affect the state, and from a small business standpoint of how it will disproportionately affect small businesses. But not exclusively how it will affect various different communities disproportionately. And I think that's going to be a big help. It won't be all the legislation that comes before the state. It's just going to start with criminal justice related bills that changes the census guidelines and things like that. But I'm hoping that once we get our foot in the door, we can spread that out to things like education and healthcare and housing that is critically important. We know the way healthcare critically, you know, this year has disproportionately impacted communities of color, but low-income communities broadly across this nation if you don't have access. And we need to be reviewing everything from a racial equity standpoint to make sure we're not doing more harm than good. I have a bill that's creating health equity communities Essentially, what we're going to do is, this might be controversial to y'all, but we would increase the alcohol tax by a penny on the dollar. It would generate about $22 million annually. And then we're dedicating all of that money to underwrite the cost of healthcare professionals moving into communities that don't have access to doctors or hospitals or dentists or therapists, because mental health is also important. We need to destigmatize mental health. And that would be both in the urban sector, places like East Baltimore, Capitol Heights, Whedon, places like that, but also the rural sectors of the state that they often have to drive 45 minutes to an hour to get to an hospital. And because of that, they don't go to see a doctor, right? The medical cost for these companies will be underwritten so that you don't really have to worry about if you have insurance or not. Because we know that many folks don't go to get the needed treatment that they need because they either lack insurance or they're afraid that it's going to bankrupt them or what have you. So we're trying to pay for the preventative stuff on the front end before it gets bad. I did have a baby boy earlier this year. He is, to this day, he is 13 weeks. I'm gonna put up a little picture of baby Miguel for you guys. It says, you probably can't see it because the highlight, but it says babies for Biden on his shirt. When I found out that my wife and I was going to have a child, but in particular a baby boy, in this year where we've had, George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, everything, it's just, it had my mind going through all the interactions I've had with law enforcement and other things when I didn't do anything wrong, but I just happened to be at the wrong place, wrong time, and have the wrong color. That I thought, you know what, we need to do all we can now so that my son and many of your children don't have to have the same experiences again, pulled over or pulled out of a car because police officers are forced to do these fishing expeditions for a failed drug policy, right? So I've talked to many officers about cannabis in particular. They feel like it's a waste of their time. They didn't sign up to be pulling over and throwing kids around. They signed up to incarcerate real bad people, right? Folks who are doing violent crimes, folks who are preying on the elderly and children and things like that. Not teenagers being stupid, not young people being stupid that they're being forced to right now. So I have a bill on bringing forward a racial equity focused cannabis legalization bill. I'm more than happy to talk to you guys about that. It would allow for expungement of records first and foremost for the people who have been incarcerated because folks are making millions of dollars for things that people are still in jail for. It would dedicate the lion's share, over 80% of the resources to disproportionately impacted communities. A quarter would go to our HBCUs off the top to their endowments to help strengthen them. Another quarter would go to the over-policed communities where they could have dedicated funds. And I'll tell you, in the state legislature, too often we spend money on things that we don't reach the communities that's most at need precisely. We do it through indirect measures and then hope that it trickles down. So education is one of the ways we do this. We increase education funding and it helps everyone. But the problem with that is that it helps the well-to-do as well as the not well-to-do, right? So it's not like the not well-to-do is getting it disproportionately more so they can catch up. And that's what this is trying to do. They can use the resources for anything such as, housing, workforce development, youth programming, you name it. And the third component of the bill deals with social equity businesses, which is, minorities, but not just minorities, anyone who lives in a disproportionately over-policed communities. That could include places like Dundalk in Baltimore County, which are overwhelmingly white, but also over-policed. And they can get preferential treatment in getting a license. They get dedicated funding because it's the Schedule I drug, so you know they can't go to the regular funding places to stand up their business as well. there are a number of things we're going to do this session to strengthen higher ed as well, but I'm going to stop there just because I can go on and on about the different things we're working on that I'm excited about. But I told Sola I really want to hear from you all and how it's going on the ground, on campus, and how I can be a conduit as much as I can. So thanks for having me. And let's wrap.
Thanks. And so what we're going to do now is going to open up to questions. Brandon Dula and Ms. Carswell are going to call on people. Just use the icon to raise your hand. And when they see your hand raised based on the order that that it comes in, Brandon or Ms. Carswell will call your name, and then you can ask Delegate Jazz Lewis your question or leave your comment.
So I'll jump in for a couple of things. So first, Jazz, congrats for being a father. And so I know that you sort of kind of met Irene and Micah, because she worked with Micah when you
She worked for Brandon. And, I'm not gonna lie, I went to Brandon and James Mishay, who used to be there, because I went by the office. I was in grad school and I saw her there, and you know, don't judge me too harshly for this. I walked by her at first because I was a little nervous, and I asked them for like the 411 so I could build my confidence and then go talk to her. I appreciate the help.
But just want to say congrats on that. And something else that I did want to mention about you is I know you were part of Community Roots, you know, and that group was amazing on campus. And so you were one of the founders, you know, doing great things with that group. So
our movement that we created was called Students Taking Aim to Reclaim Our Education. I didn't really intend on going into politics. It actually was that experience that got me interested, because, you know, I worked my way through undergrad. I worked at the Quality Inn Hotel, which doesn't exist anymore. It's been torn down. And I played my guitar at local churches. I used to play at the juke joint. You know, during the recession, the legislature proposed increasing tuition, which would have priced out folks like me and a bunch of my friends. So we got upset. And then on top of that, we found about that the university was thinking about pushing out Dr. Cordell Black, who had been a defender for equity on campus, that we kind of lost it. Thankfully, Dr. Z and Ms. Carswell and them opened up Nyumburu for us to have a town hall. We didn't anticipate that like 600 students would fill that room that can only fit about 250 people comfortably. It was definitely a sweat box, but it turned into an organizing meeting. And the next day, about 1,000 students descended on then President Dan Moat's office. And me and a couple friends got pushed into him and Farberding's office to negotiate what it would take for us to stand down. And that's what taught me that people power changes things. So I kind of moved from originally planning to study architecture into politics and going to becoming community organizer, union organizer, all that. But yeah, I owe the university a lot. Oh, hi Saba, by the way, too. I forgot to mention her.
Hello, good afternoon. Thank you for talking to everyone.
So how's it going? I mean, I know a lot of the students are remote. You know, this fall, I imagine there's some consternation about, I just heard that students will be coming back this spring, you know, to the different residence halls. And,
so that's why I did so many black men. That means,
is that Dr. Grant Wisdom?
Yes, sir. Hi, how are you?
I'm doing just fine. It's good to see you.
You know me already. I was eating my lunch. You show my face just quite yet. But congratulations. I see you had a son. How wonderful for you. And it's great to see your face. Wow.
Thank you. I missed you.
I miss you too. But tell me, in terms of being a delegate, do you get any static in terms of racial issues and all that stuff? And, you know.
Yeah, all the time. Yeah, all all the time. Matter of fact, I, you know, we have, hopefully this is a conversation where we can all be honest with one another.
Yep.
A delegate who chairs the Judiciary Committee, his name is Luke Clippinger. He's a state prosecutor in Anne Arundel County while representing a district out of Baltimore City, right? A bunch of organizers from a group called Leaders from a Beautiful Struggle wrote an op-ed against him last week, saying that, they weren't calling him racist, but they were saying that he doesn't work from a racial equity standpoint, so essentially he maintains the status quo. And they had a lot more strong language than that on how they said it. So then I'm in a call with him, and you know, he means well, and I'm in this weird spot of being like, well, I know you're a good person, but I also know they're not necessarily wrong, you know? So we have to push. It's like when you get into these spaces, whether you are, you know, a minority or a woman, you often have to push for them to expand the conversation. Because like, look, I'm not saying you're a bad person, but policy affects people's lives, you know? So it's not about whether I agree or like you as a person. It's about what we need to, you know, what we need to do to change the quality of people's lives. So I'm often bringing up racial equity. And fortunately, because of the times, people are receptive to it. But when I first got into Annapolis a couple years ago, it was, you know, folks are a little less so. They felt like I was crying, you know, wolf or something. And were trying to, you know, ostracize me to like, that's jazz, you know. Now, because of my training at the University of Maryland, I always came with a ton of data. So, you know, it's not like this is my opinion. These are facts, right? 87% of the juvenile lifers in the state of Maryland are Black, in a state that only 30% of the population is Black. That is a fact, you know? You know, we are the worst in the nation. The next state that has the highest, you know, juvenile lifer population that is largely Black is Louisiana, and they're at 76%. So we're worse than Mississippi, Louisiana, all of them. You know, so, it's a fight, but you got to get creative. And that's one of the things I do like about people power. You know, I think, you know, when you organize and you get a ton of constituents, particularly in those folks' district, to call them about something, they tend to pay a little bit more attention.
Wonderful.
Thank you. Mark or Saul Walker, Saul. Well, I know you guys have a question.
Okay. Thanks, Solomon. Good afternoon, Delegate Lewis. My name is Saul Walker. I'm from University of Maryland at College Park. I'm a chief steward with the union at College Park, and also I'm a vice president of higher ed. And I'd like to say good afternoon and a great day after the Martin Luther King birthday day, you know?
Yeah.
But I was talking about a situation that we have that's growing up in higher ed, and we put in a bill to consolidate the contract of all the schools together. We're supposed to have a lobby night on Monday, you know, and I was calling to, been on the Zoom to ask if you and some delegates could, you know, join us on Monday, because this consolidation bill for all the schools is something very important, because we want to be together like on one page, you know, and if.
So this is for collective bargaining, right? Mm-hmm. This is for collective bargaining you're referencing,
yes,
right?
Yes,
yeah.
Yes, collective bargaining. And this one contract will be very good, so everything being tied together, and we just have to do one negotiation, you know, one contract at one time. Instead of doing what we're doing now is, you know, hey, each school got to negotiate, you know, and it costs everybody money on doing that, you know. And we really can't get ourselves together where we on just on one good footing, you know, to know what all the schools are doing and know what we have to do for everybody. So we do think this is very important to have this bill, you know, passed, so we can't have just this one contract.
Yeah, you could send me what time it is on Monday. I'll be on there.
Oh man, oh, we'll sure appreciate it, because you know we can use your help, man. We can use your help, you know, to get this going, you know, because we've been working hard for a few years on this, you know, and we're trying to bring it home now, so you know we can all just, you know, hey, get together on all the schools on those 3 years and just bring it through, you know.
I assume everyone knows what Saul's referencing, but just in case you aren't aware, you know, the AFSCME and the various groups that represent public sector workers have to organize often school by school, sometimes department by department, or one system. So I think the argument is we should be organizing them at the system level as opposed to the school level, so that there can be, you know, it could just save a lot of time and get more people fair wages and benefits. And I don't have a problem with that.
Dr. Lewis, you say it so very well. You are, hey, that is it. Appreciate it, man. Appreciate it.
Yeah, so Saul, if you send me those details, email me. I will email and text it to Janet so he can be on that call.
Okay, what I do, I'll talk to Mark and Mark and hook everything up.
Yeah, I'll send the stuff.
All right, thanks, Mark.
No problem.
Thanks.
Yeah. Well, how are things? I mean, I came in just after, I think there was a conversation about how things have been going with President Pines. And, you know, I should say, I recently moved over from the Judiciary Committee to Appropriations Committee. So, you know, Pines reaches out to me, you know, fairly often anyway, now that he's become the president, but all the college and universities have to come to the Appropriations Committee to get the money. So, you know, if there's points you all would like me to bring up, please let me know. I apologize for missing that on the front end, but like I said, I see my role primarily as helping be a conduit for voices that typically don't get to be heard. So, you know, let me know the marching orders.
No doubt.
I think Saba has her hand up, Solo.
Saba.
Yeah, hi there. So I did have a question for you, Jazz. You know a lot about the issues that we've been having on campus as far as race and not having the administration necessarily do enough when students call and ask. One issue that we are still going through is just one specifically is still getting a memorial for Lieutenant Richard Collins the third. So I'm honestly, the question is kind of, how do you think that we as students could effectively advocate for that, since it is something that was promised in 2018. In the most recent conversations with President Pines that I had about it, literally just in the last few months, it's something that, you know, they keep telling us to look forward to. But the bigger question is kind of like, and kind of in conjunction with the issue of getting the physical memorial, is kind of like, how can we put pressure on administration to take students seriously about these issues in kind of hate and racial justice, especially because we have the task force on community policing that was just put together this past semester, but we haven't seen any progress come out of that yet. And they said that we should look forward to seeing progress this semester, but there is really no telling because it's a group that doesn't have much representation from students or Black people.
So I'm on the task force, the community policing task force for the school. They're supposed to be wrapping that up, I believe, in February. There's that. But, you know, I know that doesn't address the representation concern. I know they did have some students on there. You know, there are you know, I'm Black, but you know, I can't represent students. I'm not a student anymore, right? So if y'all have concerns y'all'd like me to bring to that, I'm happy to be a conduit. But that should be wrapping up soon. On the memorial, I wanted to say, are you, you're referencing a physical memorial, like a physical thing as opposed to a program? Because I know he announced the scholarship that's in partnership with Bowie State University.
Yeah, we heard about, I mean, we're familiar with that in the social justice alliance that started on October 1st, 2020. Mm-hmm. And we are like in complete support of that, everything, especially that the foundation is putting out. We're like making sure to share all of that as well. But yeah, more specifically the physical memorial.
Okay. All right. Well, that's good for me to know. I can bring it up to them. The other thing you can do, I mean, it just depends on how you want to carry it, right? You know, you can reach out to legislators who they have to come for because they need resources. Or you can also organize students to just be, you know, a pain. It's hard to do that in this environment with the pandemic. Like we didn't have to worry about socially distancing when we descended on the school. We also started going to all the university senate meetings until our demands were met, you know? So I don't know to the degree that you all can also do that. But I think, you know, leveraging alumni, like reaching out to them, if you wanted to do like, you know, a letter writing campaign to the alumni board of governors, or obviously, you know, the members of the appropriations committee and budget and tax committee, where, you know, Pines has to go to get money for the school, is a place to go. You know, those are probably the most effective ones given the pandemic, you know, but, you know, you all can always stand outside his office with a bull. I mean, you know, it's up to you. I don't want to carry it.
Thank you. And I have one more follow-up question on the last note that you said about the task force for community policing. There is one issue that we brought up to administration. I'm not sure if it actually ever made it to the committee, but I'd love to send some more information over about this to you if you haven't already received it. But Black Terps Matter gave a 15-page proposal that we made talking about why we should end the partnership between ResLife and UMPD. As well as a 50-minute long webinar that we had about it. And we sent the video and the 15-page proposal over to administrators in hopes that the committee would be one of the things that you all talk about in the time that you're deliberating. I don't really, one, like, did you get that too? Or should I just send it over to you in case it would be possible?
Yeah, you send it over to me. We're mostly working in subcommittees, and I'm on the contract subcommittee where we've been talking a lot with the police department and their union, right? Over what can be included in their contract and whatnot. Like, discipline isn't something you negotiate over. There's just the standards, and there should be clear standards for discipline, not something that you negotiate away. So yeah, please send that over to me, and I'll make sure it gets addressed and follow up with you.
Thank you so much. And you know, the last minute you said is so important, and that's really good to know, because a lot of the time we talk about use of force, and we even had a march on Annapolis 2 weeks ago, and one of the demands was to decrease the use of force from police officers. So like, if you're saying that that's not one of the factors in it most of the time, or I don't know if you can actually just like expand on that kind of.
In any, you know, I feel like Mark or someone on here may understand this better than me, but in any union contract, you negotiate a whole host of things between wages, but also benefits, but often discipline, right? Like, what's the process for you taking some type of corrective action against an employee when they're part of a collective bargaining agreement, okay? And the history in Maryland has been that, like, all right, one of the things that they negotiate with, like, maybe we can't give you more pay. Okay, but we will give you more leeway as it relates to discipline. So it's become the case that, you know, I think use of force in particular, if an officer, let's say, shoots and kills someone in Maryland, they have 5 days before they have to issue a statement, because that's part of their collective bargaining agreement. It's part of, I mean, it's been written in law based on the Law Enforcement Officers Bill of Rights, but that's essentially just the state like making statutory a collective bargaining agreement that existed prior, right? So what we're saying is that you can negotiate over, you know, healthcare and, you know, time off and, you know, let's say overtime pay and things like that, but you can't negotiate discipline for issues such as like violence, right, or abuse. That's been a huge point that we've been bringing, you know, in. And it's, you know, everything's on the table often when unions and employers negotiate. So sometimes they can't do one thing, they'll do another, right? One of the big things is like healthcare. You know, it's just like, well, maybe we'll give you more healthcare benefits, but we won't increase your wage, right? And we're just saying that this should be separated from that.
Thanks a lot. I appreciate that, Sava. You know, as we draw to the end, I actually wanted those that are on, I wanted to actually, since Jazz has mentioned people power so much, I wanted to, you know, and this may make him blush, but I wanted to show people that, you know, we're not so far removed from, you know, this mass movement led by students and, you know, and then, you know, joined in by a lot of faculty, staff, administrators, and, you know, in terms of what Jazz referenced when he, at the onset of you know, his, you know, his appearance on this call. And this is just a short 4-minute video that highlights and actually shows you visually those that were not on campus. And Dr. Grant Wisdom, you were part of this because, you know, students were fighting on behalf of you, you know, staff administrators were fighting on behalf of you, like myself and Dr. Z and Ms. Carswell. And so I just wanted to show this really quickly and then I'll get Jazz's thoughts and we'll end there. So this is a video. This is what Jazz was mentioning. This was when he was an undergrad. He was a part of the creation of this organization called STAIR. And this is a video that shows that mass march. This actually happened on campus. This wasn't 50 years ago. This was, you know, not that long ago, about, I guess, roughly what, Jazz, a decade ago, something like that. And here we are right here. This is STAIR.
forgot completely about that.
Wow. Now you remember. Now you remember.
Yeah.
So that was it. Any closing comments and folks that you saw Jazz there, you saw Ms. Carswell in that video, you saw myself, saw the late great Ren McGrew. I mean, it was a tremendous, tremendous movement that happened so organically. It almost happened overnight. Ms. Carl, you remember that? It just kind of erupted, and they funneled all of that energy, which like a true organizer does, and then created a movement. So Jazz, anything?
The only thing I was gonna say is I was a few pounds lighter then. I saw a lot of friends who now I think over the rest of this week, I'm gonna call to check in on them in that. And you know, I appreciate the call. You know, there's something special, I think, about like students organizing. There's something like raw and pure about that. I try as much as possible, you know, I'm a legislator and you can get some attention, but I try as much as possible not steal attention away from particularly students who are organized on the ground, because this is their moment, this is their time. And yeah, that experience, it really changed my life. We got some wins out of it, we got some losses. You know, my only advice to Saba and any other students on there is, be flexible to get real wins for your people. Because you know, Dr. Black, he didn't stay the associate provost for diversity, but he stayed there and was a mountain of a man for many of us. You know, Dr. Grant Wisdom kept her job. We were able to keep tuition from increasing. You know, well, I should say she got to stay at the campus. She didn't stay where she was. But I don't fully know that was a bad thing. Maybe we could talk offline about that, because they were giving her a rough time. But there were other things we didn't get done. You know, we really wanted Farberton out of there. He didn't get fired. He did eventually leave the campus. You know, but
it's tenured professor.
Yeah. You know, so. Actually, that was one of the things that really helped us when we got into the room. Farberton said to us that by cutting the role for Dr. Black, he would save all this money. But we knew that he was a tenured professor, so that he couldn't fire him, and that the university was going to be paying his salary anyway. And we found out that essentially not only was the university not going to be saving money by having someone replace him, they actually were going to spend close to an additional $100,000. Which was essentially, he was just trying to remove him and put someone who was a tool who wouldn't chastise him or, you know, check him in that role. And that was unacceptable. Thank you guys for the opportunity. I'm gonna put in the chat my email if anyone wants to reach out to me on things that, you know, you think me or my colleagues can work on. I have a core group of me. I don't do everything. I mean, there's a number of other legislators that are amazing from across the state. Some of them are experts on different things. So depending on what you reach out to me about, I may connect you to one of them. But Solo and everyone, I thank you for your time and for having me on.
Thank you. Ms. Carswell, you can take us out.
All right. Thank you, Jess. And thank all of you all for participating today. So I know that we have a Black faculty staff meeting, general body meeting, but I guess that would be next month, but we'll let you know that date. So anyway, stay safe. Oh, there is some Senate seats that's opening up. I'm sure all y'all received the emails, so you may want to check that out if you're interested in being a part of the University Senate. All right, see you next time.
All right, take care. Thank you, everybody. Stay safe.
Everybody have a good day.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Peace.